Now, we have learned last time about the various types of actions done by B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. We've learned the mechanism of action of B lymphocytes. We've learned the mechanism of action of T lymphocytes. What we'll be learning about today is something which is an extension of what we learned last lecture. In last lecture, we had learned about a type of immunity which was called as humoral immunity. In humoral immunity, we had learned that B lymphocytes are responsible for producing certain proteins which are called as antibodies. We had also learned antibodies exist. We had also found out that antibodies exist on the surface of lymphocytes. Do you remember? On the surface of lymphocytes, if you remember, antibodies were acting like keys. Or we can say antibodies were acting like receptors. Today what we are going to do is we are going to actually learn the structure of that antibody molecule. We're going to learn how exactly do these antibodies function. Now, this is how an antibody molecule looks like. Each antibody molecule which is present within us is chemically a protein. You know, it belongs to a category of protein called as globulin. It belongs to a category of protein called as globulin, and it is found within our immune system. That's why antibodies are better known as immunoglobulins. You know, the short form for antibody which we use always is IgA. Sorry, why IgA? The short form which we use for antibodies is Ig. What does Ig stand for? Immunoglobulins. Chemically, these immunoglobulins are proteins. These are protein molecules, and this is how it looks like. They are actually made up of four polypeptide chains. 1, 2, 3, 4, held by disulfide bonds. All this what you see are disulfide bonds. This is nothing new. If you remember, we had learned that insulin is made up of three polypeptide chain, A chain, B chain, C chain. And all those A, B, C are also held by disulfide bonds. When you have many polypeptide chains together, it has the bonds are always disulfide bonds. How many polypeptide chains do you see? Four. That's why we say antibodies are tetrapeptide molecules. What do we call antibodies as? Tetrapeptide. Because of the presence of four polypeptide chains. Can I say this chain and this chain are small in size? Lower molecular weight. Since they have a lower molecular weight, we call these chains as light chains. What is this chain called as? Light chain. Can I say this chain and this chain are longer ones? Longer matlab higher molecular weight, more amino acids, so we call them as the heavy chain. Every antibody molecule is made up of four chains, two light chains and two heavy chains. Because they have two light chains and two heavy chains, this is what we say about them. H2L2. If they say describe an antibody molecule, we'll say H2L2. Why do we say H2L2? Because it has two heavy chains and two light chains. So we say H2L2. Is that clear? Now, this is how an antibody molecule looks like. We say it is a tetrapeptide molecule. H2L2 is a term used for that antibody molecule. What are those tetrapeptide molecules? What are these polypeptides held by? Which bond? Disulfide bonds. Now, an antibody molecule, if you observe this part, it is this part through which the antibody is anchored to the B lymphocytes. If you remember, we had learned that antibody molecules were found on the surface of the B lymphocytes. It is through this part by which the antibody is anchored. So this region of the antibody molecule is called as the stem region. What do we call it as? The stem region. This region of the antibody molecule is flexible. We call it as the hinge. And because it is flexible, this can move. And that's why they say antibodies are Y-shaped or T-shaped. At this moment, it is Y-shaped. But it can bend like that. So it will become T-shaped. So we say the antibody molecule is a Y or a T-shaped molecule because of a flexible region which is called as the hinge. Fine? Now, what is the job of an antibody molecule? What does the antibody molecule help in? It binds to the antigen. It is this part through which it binds to the antigen. If I say which end of the polypeptide, do you know polypeptide chains have two ends? What are polypeptide chains? Chains of amino acids. When you link amino acids, you get two ends. Amino group free wala end and carboxylic group free wala end. Amino group free wala end is called as N-terminal. Carboxylic group free wala end is called as C-terminal. This is your C-terminal. This is your N-terminal. So they ask you that the antibody molecule, which terminal, which end is involved in the binding of the antigen? We say the N-terminal. You see these grooves which I have made? It is these grooves where the antigen would get locked. Now you tell me, do we have one type of antibody for all antigens? No. We have specific antibodies for antigens. If this is an antibody molecule against cholera, and if I show you an antibody molecule against typhoid, will it be the same or different? It'll be different. It is this area which will be different, na? Because it is this area which binds to the antigen. So we call this region as the variable region. What do we call this region as? The variable region. Can I say even this is the variable region? This is the variable region and this is the variable region. What is a variable region? It is that region which provides attachment to the antigen. It is that region which is different from one antibody and the other antibody. Every antibody molecule is unique. It is this part which is unique. So can I call this part is the constant region? Even this part would be the constant region. What about this? Constant region, huh? So can I say this is variable region of light chain? Hello? Variable region of heavy chain. Constant region of light chain. Constant region of heavy chain. Again. Variable region of light chain. Variable region of constant region of light chain. Variable region of constant region of heavy chain. Achha, if they ask you what is the stem of the antibody molecule formed of? The constant region of the heavy chain forms the stem. Are you getting it? Okay. Now, it is this part which provides attachment to the antigen. Yes or no? We call this as the antigen binding site. What do we call this as? The antigen binding site. Antigen binding site includes variable region of the heavy chain and the light chain. How many antigen binding sites do you find? Two. One and two. How many antigen binding sites do you find? Two. So can I say every antibody molecule can bind to two antigens? And so we say every antibody molecule is bivalent. What do we say about the antibody molecule? It is bivalent. Why do I call it bivalent? Because at a time it can bind with how many antigens? Two antigens. We are learning about the antibody molecule. What are the antibody molecules also called as? Immunoglobulins. Chemically it is made up of four polypeptide chains. So we say it is a tetrapeptide. The four polypeptide chains are held by disulfide bonds. The four polypeptide chains can be classified into two types. There are two chains which are heavy and two are light. So we say H2L2. We describe antibody in short by H2L2. An antibody molecule is a Y-shaped molecule or a T-shaped molecule because of a flexible region which is called as the hinge. An antibody molecule shows the presence of a region which provides attachment to the antigen. That region which provides attachment to the antigen is called as antigen binding site. One antibody molecule is different from the other antibody molecule according to this region. So we call this region as the variable region. The rest of the part which is same in all antibodies is called as the constant region. The constant region of the heavy chain forms a region called as the stem. Through the stem, the antibody is anchored to the surface of B lymphocytes. Doubts up to this point? This antigen binding site has one more name. Can I say it is that fragment of the antibody which provides binding to the antigen? So it's called as the Fab segment. what we call it as the FAB segment. FAB stands for fragment antigen binding segment. Fragment antigen binding segment. It is that part of the antibody which provides attachment to the antigen. You know, for the very first time when they were discovering this type of antibody, and they were preserving this type of antibody for the very first time, they had used low temperature to preserve it, which is very common. If I have to preserve anything, I would always use low temperature. When they preserved this using low temperature, they found out this area, the constant regions, were getting crystallized at low temperature. They were getting crystallized at low temperature. That's why this segment was called as the FC segment, which means fragment crystalline segment. Which part is the FC segment? The constant region. Which part is the FAB segment? The variable region. Why do we call it the variable region as the FAB segment? Because it is the one which provides binding to the antigen. Doubt? Now, how does the antigen molecule come and get attached here? If I have to make a rough diagram of the antigen molecule, let's say this is the antigen molecule. It's a rough diagram, okay? Antigens are found on the surface of pathogens. The surface of a fungus, the surface of a bacteria, the surface of a virus would show the presence of an antigen. You know, it is this part of the antigen which is unique. This part is constant. This part is something which is constant. This part. One antigen differs from the other antigen on the basis of this part. Are the antigen of cholera, the antigen of typhoid, would it be same or different? It is this part which is different. Is that clear? This part, that's why it's called as the antigenic determinant. If you understand the word, it is the one which determines the uniqueness of the antigen. So what do we call it as the antigenic determinant? It is this part which would be there on the surface of the pathogen. Since it's on the surface of the pathogen, we call it as the epitope. Epi because it's above. What do we call this as? Epitope. What is epitope? The other name for antigenic determinant. What is antigenic determinant? The part which actually differs from and one antigen and the other antigen. The unique part of it. If you understand what I've done here, is I've made a shape in such a way which fits there. So can I say this antibody molecule, what we have made, is actually against this antigen? Hello? For example, if I draw an antibody molecule, I'm drawing an antibody molecule, okay? This is one antibody molecule I'm drawing. I'm drawing another antibody molecule. Okay. I'll draw antigen rather. Let's say this is the antigen against, this is the antigen present on the bacteria which causes cholera. This is home production diagram. And this is the antigen which is present again, which is present on the surface of the typhoid bacteria. This is present on the surface of the cholera bacteria. Tell me, this antibody molecule what I've made is the one which is formed against cholera. We call it as a lock and key hypothesis. We call it as the lock and key mechanism. What is this part called as? I hope you understand. This is not the one which was unique in the antigen. Can I say it was this part which was differentiating one antigen from the other? What do we call this part as? Antigenic determinant. Also called as epitope. What is unique about this? Can I say this surface, na? What did we name it as? Epitope. Huh? Can I say the epitope would get locked in here? What gets locked in here? Epitope. That's why this area is called as paratope. What do you call it as? So, what happens? The epitope of the antigen binds to the paratope of the antibody. Repeat again. The epitope of the antigen binds to the paratope of the antibody, forming an antigen-antibody complex. What would be formed? Antigen-antibody complex. You know what holds the antigen-antibody complex? Van der Waals forces of attraction. You learned this intermolecular forces of attraction. Some cases it may be Van der Waals forces of attraction. Some cases it may be hydrophobic bonds. Some cases it may be hydrogen bonds. It may be different. But antigen-antibody complex formation is this. This is what happens when antigens combine with antibody. The epitope of the antigen binds with the paratope of the antibody molecule. Doubt? Open up your textbooks. Add the labelings which are not there in the diagram. There's some labelings not there in the diagram in your textbook. Add them. You know, these antibody molecules, what we have learnt now, exist in 5 different classes. There are 5 different types of antibody molecules which exist. I've told you the short form for antibody would be Ig. The 5 different types of antibody molecules are, the 5 different classes of antibody molecules are IgA. Ig stands for immunoglobulins, and A is alpha, Greek letter. IgD, delta. IgE, epsilon. IgG, gamma. And IgM, mu. So there are 5 different classes of antibody molecules, 5 different varieties of antibody molecules. Which are those 5 different classes? There is IgA, IgD, IgE, IgG, and IgM. Each having a different property. For example, out of this, the one which is the most numerous is IgG. It constitutes 80% of the total type. The very first antibody to be discovered was this type. This is the one which is the most numerous. It's also the one which crosses the placenta. This is the one which crosses the placenta. If you remember, I had told you about immunity. There are 2 responses. The first exposure you get, you give a slower response, which was called as primary response. It is because of this. So this is involved in the primary response. If you remember, I had told you that whenever an antibody molecule attacks an antigen, it does 3 things. It does coat formation, we call as opsonization. It helps in clumping, we call it as agglutination. In case of poisons, it causes neutralization. This is very effective in neutralization. So IgG antibodies are the ones which are most numerous. IgG antibodies are the ones which constitute 80% of the total antibodies in our blood. IgG is the one found in our blood, so it is the one which crosses the placenta and goes to the child. When we say the child gets passive immunity, we had learned about passive immunity from mother to child, right? It is this which crosses. And this IgG is involved in our first response whenever we have in our primary response. And amongst all antibodies, This has the best response in case of neutralization. The second most numerous one is IgA. IgA is found in our cholesterol. This we had already mentioned. Is the one which is found in the colostrum, that is the first milk of the mother. It's also found in the tears, saliva, and intestinal secretions. And because IgA is found in the intestinal secretion, it is this antibody which you may detect in feces. It's found in intestinal secretion, so it will be out with feces. That's why this is called as coproantibody. Very important term. Coproantibody means what? Fecal antibodies. Only this type would be detected there. We had learned that B lymphocytes have receptors on their surface. And what were those? If you remember the diagram, it was the exact same diagram what we made today about the antibody. So on the surface of B lymphocytes, you had antibodies. It is these antibodies which do that. They are the ones which are found on B lymphocytes, acting as receptors. These IgE are found on surface of mast cells and basophils. If you remember, I told you mast cells and basophils were responsible for releasing a chemical called as histamine. And I told you mast cells and basophils are responsible for triggering a response called as inflammation. But when does inflammation get triggered? When there is an entry of a pathogen, when there is an entry of a germ. A germ enters into a body, a pathogen enters into a body, and when that happens, mast cells and basophils rupture. When they rupture, they trigger the process of inflammation. Mast cells have IgE on their surfaces. And IgE are molecules of antibodies. Imagine this is a mast cell. And imagine this is a IgE antibody on the surface. In some individuals, relatively harmless proteins, which can be foreign, but harmless. For example, protein found on a pollen grain. Pollen grain is a plant cell. So it's foreign to us. But it's not a pathogen. It's not something which will cause disease. But you inhale pollen when you inhale air. And that pollen goes into your nose. Your nose has areolar connective tissue, and areolar connective tissue has mast cells. And on the surface of the mast cell, you have IgE. The pollen ka protein may bind to the IgE. The IgE causes this to break. This complex formation causes this to break, causes the release of histamine. The inflammation process begins in the nose after inhalation of pollen. Was pollen a pathogen? No. But can I say your body immunity reacted to it? Was it a natural reaction? Should it occur in our body? Should our body react to pollen or ignore it? Ignore it. Can I say because of this IgE, our body reacted to it? One word for this condition? Allergies. A better word to describe the entire concept of allergy? Hypersensitivity. People suffering from allergies are those individuals where the IgE is overreactive. Where the IgE is the one which is highly aggressive, highly reactive. It starts binding to any damn foreign protein. Like protein found in the pollen, protein found on certain foodstuffs. See, when I'm eating food, I'm either eating a plant protein or an animal protein. So if I'm eating animal protein or plant protein, what is happening is, these people, when on consuming this protein, are taking foreign protein. Foreign protein means antigen. Ideally, our immunity should ignore it. But in some individuals, some proteins trigger the rupture of mast cells. Because of which antibody? IgE, causing an allergic attack. So this is the one which is responsible for allergy. Is that clear? There are people who have allergies to peanut butter. Huh? They consume peanuts. Peanuts goes into their pharynx. Pharynx has mast cells. Mast cells, they rupture, considering it is a foreign germ. Because peanuts are foreign. It's a plant protein. There's massive redness, swelling. Remember the changes of inflammation? The swelling is so much that the pharynx swells up. Pharynx swells up, pharynx gets blocked. Pharynx gets blocked, you choke to death. People can die. If you have severe peanut allergy, I can give you peanuts and kill you. Seriously. I can make a drink for you. Make peanut powder, mix peanut powder. You would not know. You'll consume. You'll find some choking sensation. You'll find uncomfortable sensation. You'll start coughing. Internally, your pharynx begins to swell up. All what you'll feel is, you'll feel something is in your throat. You'll feel irritation. Swelling goes on increasing. Ultimately, the pharynx gets so swollen that there is no passage for air. And you die. If you've seen the Dan Brown ka Da Vinci Code, one person, one albino is killed by this mechanism. Okay. Sultan. Watch. Just mixing peanut butter can kill. If you see that every place you go outside India, they always ask for allergies. Because if they don't ask for allergies and if you eat something which may have peanut, you can die. Such severe allergic attacks are called as anaphylactic shocks. Anaphylaxis means a severe allergic attack, the person can die of this. Anyways, it is this mechanism which causes it. You heard it out. Usually small antigens are ignored. You call them as haptens. Hapten matlab a partial antigen. Usually they are ignored. But sometimes what happens is, this hapten binds with another antigen and triggers.
Antibody is supposed to be specific.
Yes.
So IgE is binding to any...
IgE is a class. Under IgE, we'll have different types. This is a class. IgM would be, for example, IgG is against toxins, na? So there would be a different IgG for tetanus ka toxin. There would be a different IgG for snake ka toxin. Exactly. This is a class. I'm not saying this is an antibody type. These are five classes. Under that, you have many different types.
So the mast cell has antibodies for all?
There would be 30,000 different types of IgEs. Are you getting it? IgE is the category which is present on the surface. IgM is actually a macromolecule. That's why M also, because it's the largest in size. If it's the largest in size, needless to say, does not cross the placenta. If it does not cross the placenta, can I say the baby would never get IgM from the mother? That means the baby would always first prepare this. These are the ones which we'll get from the mother, na? This is the one which the baby needs. So the first antibody to be synthesized by the fetus is IgM. IgG was responsible for your primary response, right? This is responsible for your secondary response. We had learned the response which occurs afterwards when you get exposed for the second time, you call it as secondary response. This is responsible for the secondary response. This is regarding the five different types of antibody molecules. What are the five different types of antibody molecules? You have IgA, IgD, IgE, IgG, IgM. Ig stands for immunoglobulin. That's alpha, delta, epsilon, gamma, and mu. Is that clear? This is also called a macromolecule because it's a macroglobulin. It's five times larger than the average antibody molecule. Then IgG also. Around five times larger in size. IgA is the second most numerous one. IgA is the one which is found in our secretions. You know, it's usually, if you see, it is responsible for local protection. Tears, saliva, intestinal secretion, cholesterol. IgA is the one which is also excreted out in the feces because it's found in our intestine, so we call it as the coproantibody. IgD is the one which acts as receptors which are present on the B lymphocytes. IgE is found on the receptors, they are on the surface of mast cells and the ones which trigger allergy. Mind you, these are not that common in quantity. Yeah? This is approximately 0.2%. They just act as receptors, so they're not too much in number. IgG is the most numerous one. 80% of the total antibodies which are present in our blood are IgG types. Since it's present in the blood, it is the one which crosses the placenta. It is the first one to be synthesized whenever you get an infection. So we say it is responsible for your primary response. It is highly effective in the process of neutralization. IgM is the largest one. It is the one which is the largest and it is not crossed. It does not cross the placenta. So the baby is not going to get this category from the mother, so the baby would first produce this. This is also the one which is responsible for the secondary response. Plus, I forgot to mention, I'm adding it here, if this is involved in neutralization, the rest two changes are opsonization and agglutination. This is more effective. In opsonization and agglutination. Fine.
In case of, like, suppose you're having some food substance, you take it, then why is it always that it's not always in the throat, it can be on the face?
Depends which part is reacting.
But then all would have the same mast cells, same.
No, it's a defect. So some mast cells are reactive. You know when people lose blood, in order to save them, you could give blood to them. You call that process as blood transfusion. You know, the very first case of blood transfusion was a case in which a patient who needed blood was given sheep's blood. To save that patient, he was given sheep's blood. The patient was about to die because the patient needed blood. He was given sheep's blood. He died. As in, not surprisingly, right? He was given sheep's blood and it didn't work out. And then when human blood transfusion started, I think so the hospital which did that for the first time was Cooks County Hospital, Chicago. 99%, this was the first place where the first blood bank was created, Cooks County Hospital in Chicago. It's still there. It's still there. They found out that when blood transfusions were given, in many cases the blood transfusion was successful, in many cases the individual suffered from complications. So they found out that the blood is not of the same type. Because in the early times it was believed that all blood is the same type. Because if you check your blood, you'll find RBCs, plasma, platelets and WBCs. My blood would have RBCs, plasma, platelets and WBCs. When they did the transfusions, they found out complications were taking place. So they realized that the blood is not of one type. There were various methods by which classification of blood was done. There was various methods by which classification of blood was done. Those blood classification systems, the old system, there is a Duffy system, there's a Lewis system, there's an MN system. They were not that accurate as a method of classification. The first accurate method of classifying blood was done by a Nobel Prize winning guy, Landsteiner. He got a Nobel Prize for this entire concept and he classified blood into four types. Initially three types, a fourth type was added later, but he classified blood ultimately four types. He said, and this concept is very important, that in every individual, the RBC has an antigen, important, pay attention, the RBC has an antigen and the plasma has an antibody. All of us, the RBC would have antigen, plasma would have antibody. The antibody is such, important line, the antibody is such that it's never against the antigen of the same RBC. Repeating, every individual has antigen on the RBC, antibody in the plasma. The antibody is such that it's never against the antigen on the RBC. Matlab, if I have antigen A on my RBC, I will have antibody against A. I will have antibody against B. Is that clear? RBC, antigen B. Will I have antibody against B? I will have antibody against A. They usually write in short, in small. Will they have antibody against A? They have A antigen. So will you have antibody against A? Will you have antibody against B? So we say he has no antibodies. He doesn't have A antigen, he doesn't have B antigen. So he will have anti-A and anti-B. Landsteiner said that there are four different types of individuals. Every individual has antigen on the RBC and antibody in the plasma. Every individual has an antigen on the RBC and antibody on the plasma. The antibody in the plasma is such that it is never against the antigen of the RBC. He said individuals can be classified, individuals can be grouped according to the antigen present on the RBC. So people who have A antigen on the RBC are supposed to be A blood group. People who have B antigen on their RBC are B blood group. Those which have both antigens are AB blood group. And the ones which have no antigen are called as O blood group. Of course, AB blood group was not discovered by Landsteiner. De Castello and Sturley, two other individuals, discovered it. That's why I told you that initially we believed that there were three blood groups, A, B and O. De Castello and Sturley were discovered the AB blood group. Anyways, point is you have A blood group, B blood group, AB blood group and O. Is that clear? A is the one which has antigen A, antibody against B. B has antigen B, antibody against A. AB is the one which has antigen A, antigen B, no antibodies. O has no antigen, both antibodies. Correct? Now, when this ABO system of blood grouping was discovered, and this ABO system became famous, people did more safer blood transfusions. People having A blood group were given A blood group. People with AB were given AB, with O were given O, etc., etc., etc. They found out some cases still had complications. There were complications developing even after having a better grouping system. By the way, this grouping system was called as the ABO system of blood grouping. After the discovery of blood grouping, ABO system of blood grouping, blood transfusion did become safer. But there were some cases where complications were still arising. So let's say she is A blood group and she needs blood. They find out a person who has A blood group, they donate the blood, she suffers from complications. So that was something which was surprising, because they matched the blood group according to this system. They found she had A, she had A. There were still complications developing when she was given this blood. And that's why further study was done. Same guy, Landsteiner. And he discovered that when he checked different individuals with A blood group, he found out there were some which had A on them, there were others which had A and another antigen called as D antigen on them. This D antigen was first discovered in the rhesus monkeys, that's why it was also called as the Rh antigen. Is that clear? That means he found out that this individual's A and this individual's A were actually different, because this individual had A only on the surface, whereas this individual ka RBC had A, also had D. D is also called as Rh. Is that clear? So likewise, there were some individuals which had only B, there were some which had B with Rh. Some had A and B, whereas some had A, B and Rh. There were some with no antigen, but there was some where there was one antigen and that antigen was Rh. Is that clear? This led to the discovery of a new grouping system, which was called as the Rh system of grouping. In the Rh system of grouping, we said A blood group is further divided into two types. Those which have only A, those which have A with RH. Those which have A with RH are called as A RH positive, or loosely called as A positive. Those which had A but no RH, ARH negative. You know, instead of saying A positive, A negative, the better way to say is ARH positive, ARH negative. If you want to seem that you are smart, if you have to mislead people, you say ARH positive. You know what does it imply? When I say that my blood group is ARH positive, I'm telling you that I have A and I have RH. When I say my blood group is ARH negative, I'm telling you I have A but I don't have RH. When I say my blood group is BRH positive, matlab I have B and in this case I am BRH negative. In this case, what would I say? ABRH positive. ORH negative. ORH positive. Acha. Antibody, I should write anti-B. Anti-A. No antibodies. Anti-A, anti-B. Very important concept, pay attention here. What is the rule regarding antibodies? What is the rule regarding antibody? I will have an antibody if I don't have an antigen. Do I have B? No, that's why I have anti-B. Do I have A? That's why I have anti-A. Do I have A or B? That's why I have anti-A and anti-B. Applying the same rule, do I have RH? No. So I should have anti-RH. All of them, do they have RH? So according to this rule, all blood group negative should have which antibodies in their blood? Anti-RH. But they don't. They don't have. They don't have anti-RH in their blood, but they have a capacity to do so. I hope you're getting this. This concept is very important. It will help us to understand the very next topic which I'm doing. Can I say individuals which have negative blood group are individuals which don't have RH antigen on them? For them, RH is foreign. For all these individuals, RH is? If RH is foreign for all of them, can I say these individuals should have antibody against RH? But they don't. But they can. They can form if they get exposed to RH. So, let's do it as a practical example. Let's say my blood group is A negative. So, that means I have A, but no RH. So, for me, RH is foreign. So, I should have anti-RH. Will I have anti-RH? No. But let's say she's A positive and I get her blood. If I get her blood, I get this. I get exposed to RH. My body undergoes sensitization. My body undergoes activation. What do I start producing? Anti-RH. Got it? Doubt? Strictly theoretically speaking, which is the blood group which is safest to give? You have two types of O's. The safest to give would be the one which does not stimulate the immunity. The safest to give would be the one which does not have any antigen. Which is the one which does not have any antigen? O negative. That's why they ask you usually in MCQs that the safest blood to be transfused without checking would be O negative, which is a stupid concept. Reason. O negative is one of the rarest blood. If I am having a lab, if I am having a place which does not have any other blood group, but available, O is available, I'm in heaven. I hope you get it. This is the rarest blood. You can't say that, look, we don't have A, we don't have B. Because if you pick up random guys, you get A, B. It's very rare to get O. So you can't say that, okay, I have no blood groups available in my lab, O bahut bada hua hai. That's not something which is. So theoretically, we say O negative is the safest. Exactly, it's a completely theoretical concept. Fine? Now some extra stuff, okay? Some important matlab, not exam point of view, but it's an extra stuff, general knowledge point of view. They have found out that all individuals have one more antigen on them called as H antigen. Everyone. And I hope you understand, since it's found in everyone, it is no big deal. Can I use this to classify blood groups? No, because everyone has it. Huh? What blood group have I made? O. O negative. Anna? Can I say H antigen shouldn't be considered at all? Because it's no important antigen because it's found in all of them. There are some individuals which have a genetic defect which are born like that. Matlab they have. Anna? Can they take this? 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 His blood group is what? O negative na, aisa dekhne jayenge to. Can I say he's O H negative? Huh? He cannot take from this normal O negative. You know what kind of blood donor he has to search for? He has to search for someone who is exactly like him. Are someone who himself does not have H. Huh? This is called as Bombay blood group.
Yeah.
Never heard of this? There's a movie Kahani.
Yeah.
Which had this. Not related to the movie. It's one of the rarest blood group which you see. The Bombay blood group. There was a Dr. Bhende who discovered this. In Bombay, of course. Bhende of Maharashtra and Apna. He discovered this blood group. This, recently, I don't know, the reason I'm discussing it is because very recently there was a case where in Bangladesh there was a patient with Bombay blood group performing a surgery. They didn't find another such guy in Bangladesh. A guy from Bombay went there for donating the blood. It's not necessary that these people are bound in Bombay only. I'm just kidding. A guy from India went specifically there so that guy could perform, so that guy could actually undergo surgery. Because no surgery possible, because surgery blood loss. Blood loss, you need blood group. You need Bombay blood group only. One of the rarest blood group if you found. Is that clear? Blood banks usually have a database of people with blood group, Bombay blood group. Because if I land up there and if I say I want Bombay blood group, it's not something which is common. So usually there are databases of people who have Bombay blood group. You know them so that, suppose if I'm Bombay blood group, I'm willing to donate blood to another guy who's Bombay blood group. Because someday he will give me I need. It's a very rare blood group. You know, you could have a WhatsApp group if you want. All people having Bombay blood group and tumhara 100 bhi fill nahi hoega. So please come, I'm dying. It's a very rare type of blood group. It's a very fascinating concept if you find. These are individuals who cannot get blood at all, excepting. So it's like, if you understand, I am a person with a genetic defect. I can be saved by another guy having a genetic defect only. Is that clear? So I am always praying, if I am Bombay blood group, that people are born with genetic defects. Then only I can be saved. But this is what the concept is. Not in your portion, just, you know, some, oh my God, fact. Doubt. If I say blood group A, blood group B, blood group AB, blood group O, pay attention. Blood group A, B, AB and O. Individual with A has anti-B in it. Huh? So he cannot take with A, anything with B. So can he take this? Can you take this? Can you take this? Huh? So you can take A and O. If my blood group is A, what is circulating in me? Anti-B. So I can't take anything which is B on the surface, na? Can I take this and this? Yes? If my blood group is B, what do I have in my circulation? Barabar hai? If I have anti-A, I can't take anything which has A on the surface. Can I take this? This? If my blood group is AB, I have no antibodies. If I have no antibodies, matlab I can take anything. I can take A, B, AB, O. If I have O, I have anti-A and anti-B. Matlab, I can't take anything which has A on the surface and I cannot take anything which has B on the surface. Can I take this? This. This. These are the unfortunate people. They give to all. Can take from only O. This is Marwadi blood group. Check. They take from all. Give to none. Of course, it's a theoretical concept. It's a theoretical concept. It's an old table. They still keep repeating this. But no blood bank will say, achha, A, chahiye, A nahi hai, or O le lo. If you are A, they give you A. Is that clear? This is a very old concept, since it's there in your portion, we learn. But they call this as a universal acceptor. They call O as the universal donor. Fine. Doubt? Huh? It's a genetic defect. So there can be an individual with a Bombay blood group. Not necessarily the parent has to have a Bombay blood group. Maybe possible. Yes. We learn the inheritance. If you remember, I told you that IgA, IgB and IgI were three genes. Can it be possible that both the parents have A blood group and the child has O? What blood group is this? Father? Mother? What if these two combines? Possible. I'm just telling you this is because if there's someone who's confused, if there's someone who's doubtful, it's possible. Dad is A, mom is B, my mom is A, how am I O? Acha, father A, mother B, child O. Father A, mother B, brother A, child O. Possible? What if this and this comes together? A, B. This and this meets together. A. This and this. This and this. So there is a possibility that you may have an offspring who may be like that. A sibling like that. And a sibling like that. Or a sibling like that. Or a sibling like that. Means there would be one sibling who will be having A. Or one with B. Or one with A, B and one with O. He will say, I have gone on both the parents. मैं पापा पे गया हूँ, मैं मम्मी पे गया हूँ. तुम कहाँ से आए? Don't worry. Is that clear? Possible. I hope I'm relieved. I have relieved someone at least here. You know, this happens if you have a sibling whose blood group A and the father is A, mother is B, and you are O. And if he's your elder sibling, usually elder siblings have a habit. They tell you that you were adopted. I don't know whether you did that on your younger siblings. There's a commonest joke which our elder one does it. We picked you up from the street. And if you have this blood group, oh shit, you're gone. You were lying in a garbage. You were there in a can, we picked you up. It's possible. Acha, both parents, AB, child O. Both parents, AB, child O. Not possible. Then you were picked up. Then you were picked up for confirm. Both O, child A. Not possible. Are both O, matlab both are that. Child has to be O. Fine. Doubt. Doubt's cleared. The entire blood grouping system is 4 marks. ABO blood grouping system is 4 marks. RH system is 2 marks. Now pay attention here. Very important concept. Pay attention here. Let's say in a couple, the male is RH positive. And the female, the mother of the child, is RH negative. The male is Rh positive and the female is Rh negative. If she's Rh negative, means for her Rh is foreign. That means she will have antibody against Rh in her blood. Yes or no? Wrong. I told you that even if she's Rh negative, does she have anti-Rh? No. Can she form anti-Rh? Yes. Okay. So, the first child is born, is there in the womb of this lady. Out of Rh positive and Rh negative, Rh positive is a dominant character, and that is why there is a high possibility that the child would be Rh positive. Huh? So the child is Rh positive. Now what happens is, it's not necessary that it will always happen, but most of the times it happens is, during the delivery of this child, some of the RBCs during delivery enter the circulation of the mother. During the process of labor, when the child is being delivered, these RBCs enter the circulation of the mother, and on entering the circulation of the mother, we say they cause sensitization of the mother. What does this result in? Result would be formation of anti-Rh, which is also called as anti-D antibodies. Because Rh antigen was also called as D antigen, na? So what would be there? There would be formation of anti-Rh antibodies. Samja? This occurred when the first child was being delivered. Since the first child was being delivered, by the time these antibodies are formed, this child is delivered already. Because this is which response, by the way? Primary response. I told you it's comparatively slower. So by the time this baby is delivered, this anti-Rh is formed. Now this mother has already undergone sensitization. This mother has started forming anti-Rh antibodies in her. Let's say she gets pregnant again. Let's assume the same husband. No. No, we have to state the facts. It's science, right? We have to always tell what are the facts. So the same husband, so what is the high possibility again of the child being Rh positive? Now the child is developing in the womb of the mother. And the mother is having anti-Rh. Primary response of antibodies are which one? IgG. I taught you today. Primary response wala antibodies are IgG. And IgG can cross the placenta. So these anti-Rh would enter the circulation through placenta and destroy these. Are you getting it? The second child suffers. The RBCs of the second child get destroyed by the antibodies of the mother. Since the RBCs are being destroyed, we say the RBCs are undergoing hemolysis. That's why this disease which the second child suffers is called as the hemolytic disease of the newborn, or HDN. Hemolytic disease of the newborn has one more name. It is also called as erythroblastis fetalis. Because the RBCs are affected of the fetus. So what do we call it as? Erythroblastis fetalis. Erythroblastis fetalis would occur when the mother is Rh negative, the father is Rh positive, and the child is, first child was Rh positive. What did the first child cause? Sensitization. What did the mother produce? Anti-Rh. Did this anti-Rh affect the first child? Because the child was delivered. Okay? But if the second child is also Rh positive, then what will happen? The anti-Rh which were formed in the mother during the first pregnancy would pass through the placenta and affect the second child. The RBCs of the second child are destroyed. You call this condition as erythroblastis fetalis. If you destroy so many RBCs, the baby can die of severe anemia. So death may occur because of severe anemia in the womb of the mother itself. The baby wouldn't be born dead. If the baby survives, the baby is not going to live long because the baby would be producing very high levels of bilirubin. Because if you break down RBC, you'll also be breaking down hemoglobin. When you break down hemoglobin, you produce high levels of Bilirubin. Bilirubin is a breakdown product of hemoglobin. High levels of bilirubin, severe jaundice. Severe jaundice damages the brain. So either the baby is born dead because of severe anemia, or the baby would die soon after birth because of brain damage. Samja? That's why it's very essential to match the blood group. Is that clear? I told you many things you need to match. One of the things you can match is blood group. If a lady is Rh negative, if you are Rh positive, then there is a possibility of the second child having erythroblastis fetalis. What would be the simplest solution? First solution. Simplest solution. Don't make such a pair. So one reason, if you want to say no to someone, you can say, oh, you are negative, so you're positive. You can, if you want to dump someone, I've given you a nice reason. Oh, we learned something new, I can't continue. No. That's one method, you can thank me later. What is the second solution? Don't have the second child. No, don't have the second child. Why do you want? Bloody Indian. Have one child, be happy. What if you want to have a second child? What if you can't let go being an Indian? दो बच्चे तो चाहिए ना कंपनी के लिए घर भरा भरा लगना चाहिए. You won't have a second child. सारुकिसी यार इतना why expensive? Simpler solutions are there. Suppress the immunity of the mother. Let her die of multiple infections. Get hold of another mother, second child. Bye. I like that. I'm late. Now, you are my family doctor. Now, I'll tell you a simpler, more humane solution, more boring solution, but you prevent sensitization. You can prevent sensitization. How do you prevent sensitization? It's like a paradoxical treatment. Just listen to this. What you do is, sensitization was occurring because of the RBC of the first child crossing over and coming into the mother, na? During the first pregnancy itself, you give anti-Rh antibodies. These are artificial anti-Rh antibodies, also called as Rogam. You know Rogam? Gamma globulin, IgG. Rho because Rh. What is Rogam? These are artificial anti-Rh antibodies you inject during first pregnancy. A very small dose. What happens? When you've injected this in the first pregnancy, when these RBCs enter the mother, these anti-Rh destroy this. Samja? What about them? They are foreign. Do they belong to the mother? The mother's immunity would destroy it after some time. If you remember, I told you that when you give ready-made antibodies, it's temporary. Because when you give ready-made antibodies, it is called as passive immunity. So this, you inject in the first pregnancy. When the RBCs of the first child enter, before they could sensitize, these would destroy the RBC. You prevent sensitization. Got it? Huh? It's a very small dose. And we give it in the later part of the pregnancy, not in the beginning of the pregnancy. Don't kill the first child to get the second child. So all doctors are all Hannibals. Now, so this is the method by which you do the treatment. What is the funda behind it? What is the principle? We say prevent what? Sensitization. This is what is done. It's a very small dose, so it will destroy the RBCs of the child which are entering inside the mother. I hope you are understanding what I did. We give it in the latter part of the pregnancy. So what happens? During delivery, these RBCs enter into the mother. Na? So anti-Rh would destroy them. Then the baby gets delivered. Then these anti-Rh after some time would be destroyed. Because they don't belong to the mother. So mother's immunity would consider this to be foreign. The antibodies of the child are too... If the baby is what? Negative. If the baby is negative, the baby does not have anti-Rh.
If the baby, your question is, if the mother is Rh positive and the baby is Rh negative, the baby does not have antibody against Rh. The problem always occurred because of what? Sensitization. See, the first child never suffered. Second child suffered because of sensitization. Only if it gets exposed to the Rh. How? Mother's RBC never crossed the placenta. We've learned placenta. No, I've not taught placenta. I will teach you placenta in human reproduction. Placenta is a place where mother's circulation and blood circulation come close by. They don't mix. Only during delivery a few of the RBC of the child may cross over. And I said may. I didn't say this is something which is 100% certainty. There have been cases where you'll find, in fact, in our family, your families also, you must have noticed that your mother may be negative, you may be positive, the father may be positive, you may be the second child, nothing happened to you. It can happen. See, it would only occur when the first child led to sensitization. If there's no sensitization, nothing. It's not something which has always occur. Doubt? Just copy this for your understanding and write this also. That's it for today. Thank you.